गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल।
एक मिनट दादी, एक मिनट।
यस वी कैन हियर यू मैम।
आई एम आई ऑडिबल? हाँ ओके ओके ओके। गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल। टुडे वी हैव द फिफ्थ लेक्चर इन द सीरीज ऑफ It is in the webinar series, which is on the advanced techniques in biotechnology. So I would like to welcome all of you to this program. And we have many faculty from outside Kerala Agriculture University. Vijay Gopal sir from CMFRA. Veena, Dr. Veena and Dr. Krishna, a warm welcome. And all the faculty from Kerala Agriculture University, and I also welcome all the participants. And it is indeed a pleasure moment. It's a very proud moment for me to welcome today's speaker, Dr. Rehana Agastya. He's assistant professor from Kerala Agriculture University, and because she was our student, she was in the first batch of MSc program from Department of Plant Biotechnology. And a warm welcome to Dr. Rehana. And I would like to invite Fatima Rumaisa, the assistant professor from Department of Plant Biotechnology, to introduce the speaker. Fatima, please.
Thank you, ma'am. A warm good morning to one and all. And I'm extremely happy to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Rehana Agastya. Assistant Professor, Center for Plant Biotechnology and Molecular Biology, Kerala Agriculture University. Dr. Rehana Agastya has obtained her PhD degree from National Institute of Plant Genome Research, Jawaharlal Nehru University in 2013. Her thesis work was on development of low glucosinolate lines in Indian oilseed mustard using RNAi. She has 4 years of research experience as postdoctoral fellow at National Institute of Plant Genome Research. Dr. Rehana worked as research scientist at Agri Genome Labs, Kochi, and she joined Kerala Agriculture University as assistant professor in 2019. She has 14 research papers in her credit in highly reputed journals like Plant Cell, Plant Biotechnology Journal, Plant Cell Environment, and Journal of
Fatima, can you repeat it because it is muted?
Okay, sorry, ma'am. Warm good morning to one and all. I'm sorry for the trouble. And I'm extremely happy to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Rehana Agastya, Assistant Professor, Center for Plant Biotechnology and Molecular Biology, Kerala Agriculture University. Dr. Rehana Agastya has obtained her PhD degree from National Institute of Plant Genome Research, Jawaharlal Nehru University in 2013. Her thesis work was on development of low glucosinolate lines in Indian oil mustard using RNAi. She has 4 years of research experience as postdoctoral fellow at National Institute of Plant Genome Research. Dr. Rehana worked as research scientist at Agri Genome Labs, Kochi, and she joined Kerala Agriculture University as assistant professor in 2019. She has 14 research papers in her credit in highly reputed journals like Plant Cell, Plant Biotechnology Journal, Plant Cell Environment, and Journal of Experimental Botany. She has received prestigious awards like NASI Young Scientist Platinum Jubilee Award in 2016, INSA Medal for Young Scientist in 2015, and Jawaharlal Nehru Award for Outstanding PG Doctoral Thesis in Agriculture and Allied Subjects. She has more than 3 years of experience in CRISPR-Cas9-mediated genome editing technique. Her main research focus is on nutritional quality improvement of important food and oil crops through CRISPR-Cas9-mediated gene editing and RNAi-mediated gene silencing. I warmly welcome ma'am to deliver the lecture on the topic CRISPR-Cas, the new era of genome editing. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, Sonia ma'am and Fatima, for such a lovely words. I'm very delighted to share the information I have gathered over these years with you on CRISPR-Cas9 technology. As we are hearing from this technology from the last 2-3 years, and you know, this is the, in new terms, it is the viral technology these days. So many of you might have undergone many seminars or workshops on CRISPR-Cas9 technology already. But today I will be also covering basics of the CRISPR-Cas9 technology and how that you can utilize for your research. So I think I can start now. Is everything okay? Let me start my presentation now.
It's okay, Reena.
Okay, today my talk will be mainly organized into two parts. One is what is part one, that is what is CRISPR-Cas9 technology. And second half, I will be dealing with how you can design a guide RNA construct and proceed with your research. So first, coming to the what CRISPR-Cas9 technology is. So basically, we know that it is a genome editing technique. So what is genome editing? It is nothing but is a technique used to precisely modify DNA. It involves making cuts at specific DNA sequences with enzymes called engineered nucleases. So genome editing can be used to add, remove, or alter DNA in the genome. So, but other techniques like silencing like RNA, there you can only block the mRNA or silence the gene or knock out the gene. Here you can add, remove, or alter the sequences in the DNA. And by editing the genome, the characteristics of an organism or cell is changed. So broadly, you can classify the genome editing technologies into two. One is the first generation technologies and the second generation technology. The first generation technology, which is less popular, like the zinc finger nuclease, transcription activator like effector nucleases. These are less popular due to its complex nature of designing and delivering. But the second generation, which involves the CRISPR-Cas, is a relatively very simple technique. That's why it is very popular also. So if you see, the CRISPR-Cas9 technology is not a very recent technique. It all of a sudden it was not discovered. The initially, the first report on CRISPR came in 1987. See, it is that many years back, it was already reported. And then CRISPR name was named in 2002 only. But later in 2005, it was found that this CRISPR is involved in the immunity of bacteria as well as archaea. And in 2010, it was also found that there is another component present along with the CRISPR, which is called a Cas9, which is an endonuclease, which is required for the cleavage. And in 2012, it is found that this CRISPR-Cas9 technique can be used for targeting genome editing. And by 2030, it was demonstrated in higher organism also about the potential of this particular technique. And from then, you are hearing about this CRISPR-Cas9 technology. Until date, there are lots of paper, when more than 6,000, 7,000 publications are listed in PubMed as of now. So what is CRISPR-Cas? its full name is clustered regularly interspaced short palindromic repeats and CRISPR associated protein system. The name itself is self explanatory. Generally, it contains 21 to 37 base pair direct repeats interspaced by similarly sized non repetitive sequences, which are called spacers. So it was first observed in the E. coli. And basically, in the E. coli or bacteria, it is have memory or immune function. So that when the bacteria, they can store the memory information, so then they are invaded by the attackers the next day, they will store this information and they use it for the escape from the invaders. So this is how it works in the adaptive immunity in bacteria. So consider this as a bacterial cell. Okay, so some virus, the bacteriophage is coming to attack the bacteria. So once it injects its genetic material into the bacterial cell, some portion of the virus is get integrated into the bacterial genome. Okay, this is spacer, which is shown in the red color. So it will be integrated into in between some of the repeat sequences. So this will be used as a guide RNA or the memory sequence for the next time attack, okay, for the as a immune response. So once the next time again the similar viruses or bacteriophage is coming to infect the bacteria, it will store this information, a structure called a guide RNA structure, again with the, together with this repeat, which forms a scaffold, is formed, and this will bind with the foreign material or a genetic material and will lead to the cleavage of that particular material. That is what happens in the bacteria for its in a adaptive immunity. And later we modify this system for our benefit. So the CRISPR-Cas9 technology which we use now, this belongs to the type 2 CRISPR. That is the most common form of or type of CRISPR techniques. They are mainly, broadly they are two classes, and the class 2 comes the type 2. It is a subtype. There are six types, and CRISPR-Cas is the which we use is the type 2 CRISPR. So it's very precise and targeted genome editing method compared to the techniques like RNA or the antisense method. And comparatively, this is very less expensive and very easy to design and very user-friendly and efficient. So even the labs with the basic molecular biotechnology facilities, or those have their already standardized the mechanism of their host transplant system transformation is established. This technique is very easy even compared with the RNA technology. So this is very fast and transgene-free method also. Not all the method transgene-free, but you can go for selection of transgene free after using this method. And it is also having lesser off-target effect, and it escapes most of the regulatory processes because there are only single, if there are very few base pair modifications only happened in the genome, that can occur naturally also during the breeding process. So most of the countries, the rules are relaxed for the regulation of the CRISPR-edited plants. So if you see the CRISPR-Cas9 system, it mainly consists of two important components. One is the single guide RNA. It is also called, simply it is called as guide RNA or sgRNA. And another is a CRISPR-associated endonuclease. And the most common one is the Cas9 protein. So what is a single guide RNA or sgRNA? This sgRNA is a short synthetic RNA which is composed of, again, two components. One is a scaffold sequence, which is necessary for Cas binding. It is also called as trans-activating CRISPR RNA or TRACR RNA. So that is one component, or it is simply you can say it as an RNA scaffold. And another is a user-defined approximately 20 nucleotide spacer that defines the genomic target to be modified. Where to go and bind, which target, which portion is to be edited. That is the spacer sequence, or the spacer sequence will define that. So that generally we define, we decide which fragment of the DNA is to be edited. So that fragment is called a CRISPR RNA or CR RNA. Okay, so the transactivating CR RNA, when pairs with the CRISPR RNA, it forms the functional guide RNA. Simply while we work with the CRISPR system, we simply call the guide RNA CRRNA as the guide RNA also, because it is obvious that it is always coupled with the scaffold. So Cas9 uses the transactivating CRRNA portion as a just a guide, as a handle while cutting. It uses this portion as a handle. And the CRISPR RNA spacer, which actually directs the complex to the matching DNA sequence which is present in the genome. This 20 base pair, this CRRNA, we are designing that, and that will decide or that will guide the entire scaffold or the Cas9 complex where to go to the genome and bind and make the double-stranded cut or the genome editing. So next component is the Cas9 protein. This is a very large protein consisting of 1,368 amino acids, and it is a multi-domain with a multifunctional DNA endonuclease. So it's the specialty of this Cas9 protein is it sniffs double-stranded DNA approximately 3 to 4 base pair, that is important, approximately 3 to 4 base pair upstream of specific sequences called the PALM sequence. And this Cas9 nucleus has two functional domains for its activity. One is the HNH, one is the RUVC domain, which is marked yellow here, and another is the HNH domain, which is marked blue here. So this is the structure of Cas9 protein. And this HNH-like domain, that generally cleaves the DNA strand complementary to the guide RNA sequence, that is the actually the target strand. And the RUVC domain, which cleaves the DNA strand opposite to the target strand. So that is double-stranded. So different functional domains cleave different strands of the DNA. So there are some prerequisites for this CRISPR-Cas. So one is the genomic target should be very unique compared to the rest of the genome. So otherwise what will happen, it can go and bind to any portion of the genome and it can make double-stranded cut and cause deletion or insertion. So unexpected changes can occur. So it should be very unique to the rest of the genome, the spacer we are or the guide RNA we are selecting. And it should present immediately adjacent to a specific sequence called the PALM sequence. It is protospacer adjacent motif. Okay, this PALM sequence is basically nothing but three bases long only. That is generally for the Cas9, it is NGG. N stands for any nucleotide. It can be AGG, TGG, CGG, or GGG. Okay, so if you see the typical structure of a guide RNA, in the 5' to 3' direction, if you take, this is the PALM sequence. And there is 10 nucleotides. These are called the seed sequence. And towards the 5' end, the sequences are called the distal sequences. This is the structure of a typical guide RNA that we design. So the Cas9 protein is initially isolated, or this protein that was from the bacteria Streptococcus pyogenesis. And it is essential for the actually target binding. And this Cas9 will cleave the guide RNA spacer sequence that shares sufficient homology with the target DNA. So the guide RNA we selected should be homologous to the portion we need to edit. So how it works basically? So when present together, that means the guide RNA, the single guide RNA, that means the CRISPR RNA along with the guide RNA, that is the RNA scaffold, when present together with the Cas9 protein, and it will form a ribonucleic protein complex. So this Cas9 then undergoes a conformational change upon binding. And once the Cas9 guide RNA complex binds to the dRNA target, the seed sequences, the sequences at the 3' end will start anneal to the target DNA. So when the guide RNA anneal to the target DNA in the 3' to 5' direction, and there will be the unwinding of the strand, and the Cas9 will cut both the strands of DNA at approximately 3 to 4 base pair or nucleotides upstream of the PALM sequence. So the mismatches between the target sequence in the 3' seed sequence specificity is more important. So if you have more mismatches in the guide RNA towards the 3' end, it can even lead to the abolishment of the editing also. But some mismatches towards the 5' end is tolerated. So this is with this, the role of the CRISPR or the CRISPR-Cas9 is already over. So next is the natural mechanism which occurs in the cell started acting now. So whenever there is a DNA damage, generally what happens in the natural system, that only follows thereafter. So when there is a DNA damage occurs due to any UV radiation or any due to some other mutagenic components, what happens generally in the cell, it will try to repair it. That happens after this. So there can be different pathways. One is the most common one is the non-homologous end joining method, but it is a very highly error prone. And another one is the homologous recombination or homology dependent repair mechanism, but that is more precise. That is the common methods of double-stranded break in the DNA. So when the error prone non-homologous end joining method, which is the most preferred method in the cell, so what happens, since it is an error prone, when they try to repair or fill the double-stranded breaks, what will happen, some mismatches, sometimes wrong bases will be added in this portion. So instead of A, sometimes it will say take T, or sometimes instead of G, C something, or sometimes deletions can happen. So some after as a result, insertions or deletions, that is called indels, happens. What happens, site-directed mutagenesis occurs. That is what we get as a result of genome editing. So this is the overview of CRISPR-Cas9-mediated gene editing. If you see, this is the sgRNA, which contains the crRNA and trans-activating RNA. That means the guide RNA scaffold, as well as the target space sequences. And the Cas9 protein, when they come together, they will make a complex, and they will be directed to the DNA target, whereas there is the complementary sequence of the guide RNA. So there is followed by a palm sequence. This complex will go and bind to this DNA sequence. And as a result, conformational change of the Cas9 occurs, and the unwinding of the DNA strands at the portion occurs, and the Cas9 will introduce double-stranded breaks. And this will followed by a repair mechanism, in which non-homologous end joining method, if you follow, will result in the indels, insertion deletions, and or if it is a homology dependent repair also, some foreign material, new DNA is created, and as a result, you will get edited plants or edited events. So that is in nutshell or an overview of the CRISPR technology. So this is the basic. So there are, over the past years, there are so many advances in the CRISPR-Cas9 technology. So I'm not going into the details of this technology, advances in this technology, because they itself are a topic of further discussion. So most of the techniques they have developed to enhance the editing specificity. So we have seen that this techniques also is having some off-target effect. So most of the advancement came for increasing the editing specificity. So they have engineered the nucleons. There are so many variants for the Cas nuclease, like the Cas9 nickase, or in this case, the Cas9 nickase, it will not create the double-stranded break, only one nickase made it, and the DNA repair happens. And another is the CPF1 or Cas12. This is nuclease is considered to be more precise than more specific compared to the Cas9 proteins. So there are so many others also, the inactive or the dead Cas9, NME Cas9, SA Cas9, so many variants are also there. And another advancement is the technique is the CRISPR base editors. Here, simply one base you can change, that is the difference. Here, with the fused Cas9 nickase or the dead Cas9, fused cytidine deaminases like ApoBEC1, and these various editors are then targeted to the specific locus by a guide RNA, and they convert cytidine to uridine near the palm site. So cytidine to uridine change is caused by the deaminase enzyme. And then uridine is then subsequently converted to thymidine through base excision repair. So creating a CT change or GAM, the opposite strand. So only this change you can make using the base editors, C2T. So then comes the next technique, but it's very recent. In 2019 only this is reported, and now it is in the stage of infancy. Only few proof of concept reports are coming, that is prime editing. So it is also mediates targeted insertions, deletions, or base-to-base conversions. But here it is difference is that there no double-stranded break is needed, or no donor DNA template is required. So it mainly exploits the single guide RNA, which is longer than the usual one, and which is used as the prime editing guide RNA or PEG RNA. And it will be generally fused with the engineered reverse transcriptase. It is a kind of a search and replace base editing technology. So this is also more precise compared to the random mutations inserted by the Cas9. So coming to the application of the CRISPR-Cas9 technology or its extension, for what purpose you can use this technology. And it is mainly for making site-directed mutagenesis or for editing the genomic DNA. And mainly we use to silence the gene. We use the technology to silence the gene, means because it is, the gene is edited. So, but it can also be used for the activation or repression of the target genes or some downstream genes to a transcription factor. Here what we are doing is the dead Cas9, the domain, if the both RUBC and HNH nuclease domains are rendered inactive by some point mutations. Okay. After that, these will be tagged with some transcriptional repressor or activator sequences. And then they will be targeted to the promoter region of the transcription factors so that the transcription of the downstream genes will be affected. So in this way, if you are tagging the enhancer or the activator, the gene expression is activated, or otherwise the gene activity or the gene is repressed. In that way, you can use this technology. And another is for visualizing the genomic loss using fluorophores. Here also, this is for the basic research purpose, like whether this particular sequence is present in the genome. If you want to identify, you can tag with some fluorophores like a GFP marker, and you can target this to the genome so that you can, when you look under the microscope, fluorescent microscope, you can make out where this exactly it is present. So another method is the RNA targeting. Here in the case of CRISPR-Cas9, it was a type 2, but here it is a type 6 CRISPR system is used. It recognizes single-stranded RNA rather than the double-stranded DNA. So upon the single-stranded RNA recognition by the crRNA, the target DNA is degraded, as in the case of the CRISPR-Cas9. Here it is Cas13, it is type 6 Cas13 instead of Cas9. So then there is a mature crRNA, it will form the complex and bind to the single-stranded RNA, and it will lead to the target degradation. So RNA also can be modified. Then is the multiplexing of sgRNA or guide RNA. So instead of delivering single guide RNA, you can deliver multiple plasmids encoding different guide RNAs into the sister cell. Or similarly, several guide RNAs can be cloned into the same plasmid and also will be targeted. Either you can clone the guide RNAs in different plasmid and you can transform into the cell or plant, or you can different guide RNAs can be cloned into the same vector and then you can target to the cell. For the single guide RNAs or sgRNAs for same target gene or multiple genes in the same pathway is generally done this way. For example, if you want to silence a pathway, a particular pathway which is required in, involved in the negative or anti-nutritional factor, for example, how to silence a pathway. So you can make a guide RNA construct or CRISPR construct, or you can design the guide RNA for all the genes present in the pathway, starting, for example, six genes are involved. So the guide RNA for all the six genes can be designed and they can be cloned into the same plasmid, and you can transform your plant or system using this multiplexed guide RNA vector. So, but there is one condition, and each guide RNA must be expressed from its own promoter. For expression of the guide RNA also a promoter is required. So from each guide RNA, there should be a separate promoter for its expression. This is very actively used these days in research, and it's very efficient, especially when you have to downregulate large number of genes together. So for multiplexing single guide RNAs or sgRNAs, there is another cloning method also developed. It is called the Golden Gate technology, developed by New England Biolabs. So in that one, you have to, you can fuse large number of guide RNAs using a sewing kind of reaction, and you can assemble them into a single construct. So in that case, each guide RNA will be followed by a promoter, then the guide RNA, then there will be a scaffold and terminator. Next, for the next guide RNA also promoter, guide RNA, scaffold and terminator. And that way you have to assemble the sgRNA. And another one is the CRISPR library. So you can large scale and simultaneous mutation screens are possible, especially in the case of model plants like Arabidopsis thaliana, and I think in the case of rice is also it is available. So here a pool of CRISPR vectors is cloned and maintained as a library in the case of in the agrobacterium, and later it will be transformed in the plant. So different plants will be harboring different target and different mutations will be harbored. So it is a kind of a library or just a data collection kind of thing. For mutation screens, you can use this one, like the tDNA screening library and all, which is present already in Arabidopsis. This similarly to that one. And especially people who are working with the killing and all, they can use this kind of library for their functional validation. So another extension or advantage you can say of the CRISPR-Cas9 technology is that transgene-free editing is possible with the RNPs. Generally, we do transformation in plants using agrobacterium-mediated method. So generally, it will be transgenic. Okay, but here in the CRISPR-Cas9 technology also, you can transform with the agrobacterium, and but in the later stages, the plants will, when it is segregate, you can select for such plants which are having the mutation, but they are free of the Cas9 or CRISPR-Cas cassette. Such plants you can segregate in future in that way also. But another straightforward method is the RNPs, ribonucleoprotein complexes. Nothing but just you have to isolate or purify the Cas9 protein in large quantities, and you have to complex it with the guide RNA of your choice. Just you can perform the reaction in the lab bench itself, and just to complex the guide RNA with the this Cas9 protein, and then you can directly deliver this into your system using either electroporation or particle bombardment. So here is no interference of agrobacterium or tDNA portions, or even selection marker is not there. So since there is no selection marker, there is obviously the problem of screening out the transformants, but that you can do easily based on the morphology or the means sequence analysis. And this is a rapid mode of genome editing. So if you just, generally it is done in the protoplast and all. So you are not sure, okay, if you are designing a single guide RNA for a gene, it is not necessary that it will work. So always you will be selecting large or at least 2 to 3 number of guide RNAs when you work. So which guide RNA is the best one? If you, or the which one is the best for my trait which I require? So if you are doing agrobacterium transformation, you have to wait for a long time to see your result, maybe to 4 to 5 months or minimum to see the result. But in the case of RNP, you can see the result within 3 to 4 days. That is an advantage, and you will get transgene-free plants also. But a very problem associated with this RNP is, since we are doing it in the protoplast, protoplast regeneration is required for getting the stable transformants. So this is very highly efficient and transgene-free method. So once your system is, if you're working with a system in which protoplast regeneration is standardized, this method you can try for developing transgene-free plants. So as we project, CRISPR is also not having all the positive effect. It is also having some constraint. One is the potential off-target effect. Actually, CRISPR is also not completely free of off-target effect, but you can take care so that you can reduce the off-target effect to a great level. Another is the problem of mosaicism. So sometimes the population generated will not be uniform in the genetic makeup. So another problem which occurs is the genomic sequence data is needed to design the guide RNA construct. That is a big constraint for the plants which are very rare, or the genome sequence data is not available. If you have the gene sequence data, obviously you can design the guide RNA and you can target for CRISPR. But the problem is that in that case, you cannot control the off-target effect. So if genomic sequence data is available, that you can take care of. So genomic sequence data is needed if you want to complete your experiment. So that will be better. So there are already so many reports on the application of this CRISPR-Cas9 technology for crop improvement, like for biotic stress in maize, wheat, soybean, tomato, potatoes, cassava. So many plants are already cucumber modified using the CRISPR technology. And similarly for abiotic stress also, so many examples are already there, how they have used which gene and what was their phenotype. And for nutritional and other trait also in rice, wheat, maize, soybean, potato, cassava. So already people tried all this and published even in 2014, 15, 16. Okay, so that is about one thing. Next one is the regulatory aspects of CRISPR. So CRISPR is expected to create lesser concern in regard to the means in the context of a regulatory aspect. In May 2020, the US Department of Agriculture, they have decided that they will not regulate the plants that have been modified through the genome editing, because they could have also been developed through traditional breeding method also. That time also some mutations or one or two base changes can occur. So they have decided that they will not regulate the plants which are modified using the genome editing. But in July, as of July 2018, the European Union, they are saying that they will be strictly regulate the genome edited plants as in the case of the normal transgenic plants or genetically modified plants. And India, regarding the commercialization, the guidelines are not yet ready. But for the research of CRISPR-Cas, they are putting it as in the biosafety level 1, saying that if the single nucleotide changes are, they are admissible because they can happen naturally also. So, but to what extent and it will be regulated, it is not, right now it is not clear. But in coming years, it will be more clarity we will get in this matter. So I would like to play a small video on this CRISPR right now. That will be very useful to summarize what I have talked, right? Yeah. Hope it will play.
The CRISPR-Cas9 system is a tool for cutting DNA at a specifically targeted location. The technique has already revolutionized gene editing, but scientists are always looking for new possibilities. So what else can CRISPR do? Since being discovered in a bacterial immune system, CRISPR-Cas9 has been adapted into a powerful tool for genomic research. There are two components to the system, a DNA cutting protein called Cas9 and an RNA molecule known as the guide RNA. Bound together, they form a complex that can identify and cut specific sections of DNA. First, Cas9 has to locate and bind to a common sequence in the genome called a PAM. Once the PAM is bound, the guide RNA unwinds part of the double helix. The RNA strand is designed to match and bind a particular sequence in the DNA. Once it's found the correct sequence, Cas9 can cut the DNA. Its two nuclease domains each make a nick, leading to a double strand break. Although the cell wall tracing process is error-prone and often inadvertently introduces mutations that disable the gene, this makes CRISPR a great tool for knocking out specific genes. But making double-strand breaks isn't all CRISPR can do. Some researchers are deactivating one or both of Cas9's cutting domains and fusing new enzymes onto the protein. Cas9 can then be used to transport those enzymes to a specific DNA sequence. In one example, Cas9 is fused to an enzyme, a deaminase, which mutates specific DNA bases, eventually replacing cytidine with thymidine. This kind of precise gene editing means you could turn a disease-causing mutation into a healthy version of the gene, or introduce a stop code on at a specific place. But it's not all about gene editing. Several labs have been working on ways to use CRISPR to promote gene transcription. They do this by deactivating Cas9 completely, so it can no longer cut DNA. Instead, transcriptional activators are added to the Cas9 by either fusing them directly or via a string of peptides. Alternatively, the activators can be recruited to the guide RNA instead. These activators recruit the cell's transcription machinery, bringing RNA polymerase and other factors to the target and increasing transcription of that gene. The same principle applies to gene silencing. A CRAB domain fused to the Cas9 inactivates transcription by recruiting more factors that physically block the gene. A more outside-the-box idea for using CRISPR is to attach fluorescent proteins to the complex. The DNA sequences are found in the cell. This could be useful for things like visualizing the 3D architecture of the genome, or to paint an entire chromosome and follow its position in the nucleus. CRISPR has already changed the face of research, but these new ideas show that what's been achieved so far could just be the tip of the iceberg when it comes to CRISPR's potential. Whatever comes next, it seems the CRISPR revolution is far from over.
I think it was a very wonderful small animation video. I think all must have understood basics about the CRISPR-Cas9 technology. Shall we move to the second part?
Yes, Reena, please proceed.
Okay. So now we will see some of the practical aspects of the CRISPR-Cas9 technology, how you can design the guide RNA construct and proceed. So this is the CRISPR-Cas workflow. This generally takes, minimum it will take 4 to 5 months for developing the edited plants and screening them. Like it will, first step is the designing, then cloning the particular guide RNA construct into a suitable vector, and deliver it into the plant system or the cell using the desired or standardized method you already following. And this, then you, once the plants are regenerated, you can screen it for the presence of mutation. So the entire process will take around 5 to 6 months. So coming to the first step for designing guide RNA construct, you have to retrieve the target gene sequence from the publicly available database. So you can download the sequence from either from the NCBI or phytosome.net. There are so many sequences are available in this website. You can go for that site. And for arabidopsis, if you are designing, you can look into the tire. And for rice and all MSU site, you can search for getting the genome information. So, and it is recommended to sequence your particular target gene even though the genome sequence will be available. For example, in the case of rice, the genome sequence is available for the Japonica cultivar, but you are going to work in a Indica variety. So it is better you sequence the particular gene. For example, you are going to downregulate a gene, like a particular gene A. So first you have to identify the sequence from the available database and make specific primer for that gene and amplify and see it in your particular variety, whether that gene sequence is intact in your that variety. That is will be better before starting your guide RNA designing. So then you have to analyze the gene structure we obtain. Find out the exons and introns where they are present. And generally genomic DNA sequences are used as input to design the guide RNA. So you have to find out the exons or introns as well, because that will be needed in future. And for activation or repression, generally 5' UTR region or the promoter region is generally preferred for designing the guide RNA construct. So next you have to select a suitable software for designing the guide RNA. So there are so many softwares are available now, but for the case of plants, and generally CRISPR-P version 2, that is the most popular one. You can also use CRISPR plant, and there are other softwares for the animal system and or human, Argen, eCRIS, CRISPR design, they are also available. These all are freely available tools, you can use them. So if you open the window of a CRISPR-P software, it will look like this. Okay. then you what you have to do is you have to just upload your DNA sequences, genomic DNA sequences in the space provided. Here there will be some questions which PAM you are using. So if you are Cas9 you are using, you can select for NGG, and then what which promoter you are going to use. So basically for RISE or monocot, U3 promoter is used. But in the case of the dicot plants or Arabidopsis, U6 promoter is generally used. So you have to select which promoter you are going to use. And then the RNA scaffold that is universal to the all the CRISPR construct or the vectors, but that is uniform, no need to change anything there. And then guide sequence length, it is generally kept as 20 base pair. And which is the, then no need to put this locus and anything because you are already providing the sequence information. So once this is filled in, you can just click this submit button. Okay, so when you click that button, you will, the result window will appear like this. So the software will suggest a list of potential guide RNAs. There can be so many number of guide RNA, because obviously only PAM 20 base pair followed by PAM sequence, that is the guide RNA. So in the genome, there will be large number of sequences. So the software like a CRISPR-P, it will list the guide RNAs in the order of merit. But in the case of other softwares, they will not say you which one is the best one, that you have to manually see each and every characteristics and then you have to look into it. But in the case of CRISPR-P, it will suggest which is the best one, that will be listed one, and it will also show a on score value, that means what is the efficiency or expected calculated efficiency of particular guide RNA. So the higher will be the better, and then it will show the sequence, and the green highlighted sequence is the PAM sequence, and the where it is present, whether it is present in the CDS region or in the UTI region, etc., it will show. So you have to select the guide RNAs which is present in the CDS region, that will be better. Then the GC content also will be displayed. Generally, similarly as in the case of primer designing, here also GC content, 30 to 80% GC content is good for the guide RNA design. So software will decide, give this list of guide RNA also, and when you select particular guide RNA, it will be the graphical representation is also here, it will be highlighted where that particular guide RNA is present in the gene. This is the length of the gene, and where this particular guide RNA is located, that will be shown or displayed here. Okay, the red ones are the best ones, followed by the green ones and the black ones, the markings. So where the location of this particular guide RNA or the spacer RNA or the target sequence, whatever you can say. In the practical, when do it, we simply say guide RNA for this spacer sequence. Okay, for the CRRNA, that is called the guide RNA when we design experiment. Okay, so you can select this guide RNA, and when you select the guide RNA, and another window is here in the right side, another panel is there, that will show the off-target value of this guide RNA. So how many off-target sites are present for this particular sequence in the genome, that will be also displayed here. For example, here it is showing 24, and what are they, it will be displayed here. So if it is present in the intergenic region or in the UTI region, no need to worry much about that. But if it is that sequence is present in the CDS region, you have to be a little bit cautious. So you can select based on the off-score value, it should be minimum off-site number of target sites also should be present. So if you see the window a little bit bigger, similarly, higher the sequence similarity at the 3' end, that is the seed sequence, the higher the off-target risk. So you can check if you guide RNA 2 is selected here. So it is showing what are the, how many off-target sites are there, 16 are there. Okay, and what are the possible off targets, it also will be displayed here. What is the target score, how many mismatches are there, what is the location of that particular off target sequence in the genome, everything will be displayed here. And this information on the off target effect will be useful for you for your future analysis. Once you get plants, how you can check for how much off target effect has happened, that you can analyze in future if you have this information. So this is also very important. And this off-target information is not provided by any other software. So CRISPR-P is best software in terms of giving this information also. So based on these things, you can select where exactly at the which position of the guide RNA is situated. Better to select the guide RNAs which is present in the exonic region, and on-score value should be high. And try to select the guide RNA which is present in the CDS region, which is having a maximum less number of off-target sites also. So these many things, so many things you have to take into consideration while selecting a guide RNA. So there are some advanced parameters also to check your specificity or efficiency of your guide RNA design. That is the secondary structure and microhomology. The software will also tell you to select based on that one, which one is the best one, like for than less than 12 total base pair for number of base pairing with other bases, and secondary structure for that 3 intact stem loops, like that is okay for the guide RNA design. Like that, it will search a list of advanced parameters also. This is, even if you don't go into this one, it is not that much going to create problem in your research. You can, the basic things at least you should follow for selecting the guide RNA. So location of the guide RNA is very important, because for knockouts, you have to select guide RNAs from the early exons or functional domains of the gene. Because if you are selecting a guide RNA towards the extreme 3' end, sometimes almost the protein will be formed, maybe that truncated protein also will be functional. So don't go to the extreme 3' end of the gene. Better to select from somewhere in the early exons, so that the protein or the stop codon, if it is getting inserted, the protein synthesis get abolished. Otherwise, sometimes a little bit activity of the protein can be happen also with the truncated protein. So don't go towards the extreme 3' end for selecting the guide RNA. But for in the case of knock-in, you can also use introns also, but in that case also, exons are better choice. And for a safer side, always select 2 or more guide RNAs per target gene. So you are not sure, these are also software predicted. If you are selecting a single guide RNA, and sometimes it will not create any mutation, you have to go back to the entire process. So better you always select at least 2 to 3 guide RNAs for your work. And after designing your guide RNA, next step is cloning. So for cloning, this is also restriction-based cloning. So after designing your guide RNA, you have to add the restriction enzyme site to the both the end of your strands. Like as in the case of primer, here also we are designing the guide RNA as the top strand and bottom strand. They are getting artificially synthesized using the primer designing company like IDT or Sigma, wherever you can get it synthesized as normal primers. But here you have to add the restriction site in the top and the bottom strand of your guide RNA. So most of the commercially available vector for the CRISPR-Cas9 technology, now we are purchasing from Argene or like publicly available platforms, most of them will be having the restriction enzyme site BSA1. It is a type 2S restriction enzyme. So our BBS1 is also rarely present. So you have to add BSA1 site to both the end of the guide RNA you designed. Okay. And when you send it for ordering the oligos, you make sure that PAM sequences are not included in the top and bottom strand. The PAM sequence is for just your information when it is designed or given by the software. But when you send it for designing your primers or synthesizing your primer, you remove the PAM sequence from the guide RNA, add your restriction enzyme site, and give it for synthesis. So once you are now your guide RNA is ready, you will receive it as a top strand and bottom strand in 2 separate tubes, as in the case of primer source. So what you have to do is, once you get these guide RNAs, you just have to anneal the top and bottom strands together. Nothing you have to do in that one. They will anneal by itself. Just you have to dilute it as usually, as in the case generally, to a concentration of 10 picomoles. And then equal molar concentration, you have to mix them in an append of 2. Added again with the nuclease free water. And just keep it in a PCR machine at 98 degrees Celsius for 5 minutes. And then cool it slowly down to the room temperature to 25 degrees Celsius. That symbol is the annealing reaction. Nothing you have to add extra. It will by anneal itself. So once you are now, you are the bottom and top strands, they are annealed together. When they anneal, they will be in such a way that they will be having the protruding restriction enzyme sites on both the ends. Okay, so your guide RNA, annealed guide RNA is ready in one tube. The next thing you have to restrict digestion should be done in the binary vector which you are going to use. So for the selection of binary vector, there are lot many binary vectors are available in Adgene. You can purchase it from Adgene. It costs less than 10,000 rupees including all the tax and all, maybe 9,500 or around. So first you should be clear about which vector you have to purchase. You can go to the literature where people have used the similar vectors in similar system. For example, the monocots, it will be different, dicots different, for multiplexing different, so many variants are there. So if you are working with rice, for example, you can use the selection marker which you want to use. So based on all these criteria, you can choose a suitable vector from the Adgene site and you can order it. For in the case of rice, generally we use hygromycin selection marker and rice U3 promoter for expressing the guide RNA. The final construct will look like this. The promoter, simply you have to clone this guide RNA in the vector available, nothing else. Other things like Cas9, guide RNA scaffold, everything is present in the commercially available vector. Simply clone this guide RNA, annealed guide RNA into the BSA1 site or generally the restriction enzyme present in the required vector. So you have to restrict and digestion should be performed in the vector. And then you have to ligate the vector and the annealed strands together and transform to E. coli. And then confirm your sequences in the E. coli, whether it is cloned or not. And then mobilize your construct into the agrobacterium. Or then you can transform your plants or system with the agrobacterium and confirm further and go for your genetic transformation experiments. So once your clone is ready in the agrobacterium, then you can transform your system. Like for example, stable transformation, it is always easy to go for the agrobacterium mediated method. That will be standardized in almost all the labs. So you can choose that one, either callus mediated, or if you're working with arabidopsis, you can do for a floral dip and you can regenerate your plants. Okay. So for the transient expression also, you want to check the efficiency, which guide RNA is working better. And or in that case, you can even use the protoplast system and you can do a gene gun experiment or electroporation. Or for tobacco, you can even go for the infiltration technique. So that is of your choice, which technique of method of transformation you wish to do. So once you regenerated your plants after transformation, then now we have to screen for the edited plants or the CRISPR or mutated plants. So first you will be selecting whether the transformants based on your selection marker. So after that, nothing you have to, it's very simple. You have to just isolate the genomic DNA from the plants or edited or the transformants. Just isolate the genomic DNA. You have to put this, you have to give it for sequencing. That's enough for identifying the mutation. So you know where the target or the guide RNA is present in the gene. For example, for a 1 KB gene, for example, you have selected the guide RNA from the base pair, 300 base pair length, that portion you have selected your target or the guide RNA was there. Okay, so design a primer such that portion will be amplified. No need to amplify the whole 1 KB gene. Somewhere near the maybe 500 base pair portion you can amplify. That flanking primers to your target sequence should be designed and simply amplify that portion which include your target region also. So simply you put a piece, isolate the genomic DNA, put a PCR with a specific primers, flanking primers that can amplify your the target region and then give it for sequencing. Okay, so earlier paper, simple Sanger sequencing is enough for detecting the mutation. No need to do NGS or whole genome sequencing, anything at this stage. Simple sequence Sanger sequencing is enough. Earlier paper used to do restriction assays or T7 endonuclease assay, surveyor nuclease assay. No need to do anything. This one is very simple. Based on my experience, I am telling you can go for a Sanger sequencing. So once you get the Sanger sequencing result, it will look like that. When you analyze it, it will be look like this. Okay, so any sequence alignment software which you are routinely using in your lab, you can select that one. Here I have used the sequencer software. So this is the data of my work I have done previously. For example, this was my mutant plant which I generated by CRISPR. and this is the in rice, so it is IR60 for wild type, and you align your guide RNA sequence also to test for the mutation detection. So when you align the sequence, you can find if the mutation is there. See this portion, this was your guide RNA, versus the AGG palm was there, and around 3-4 base pair upstream of this particular palm sequence, we can see in the mutant there is an insertion of A sequence, which is not present in both the guide RNA as well as the wild type sequence. This is the mutation. Addition of a single base A is happened here. So we will see in we study in theory, but literally you can see it very beautifully if you get the mutation. It's exactly 4 base pair upstream of this palm sequence, you can see an insertion of A. So you will be thinking that this can be a sequencing error also. It is not, because anyway you have to do repetitions, replications. You will be with a set of DNA, you will be isolating and confirming it, and moreover see the space where the region where the mutation has occurred, this palm sequence and the 4 base pair upstream to that. This was an another experiment with the another gene. Here also you can see a different pattern we obtained. There are 6 deletions and 1 addition up to 3-4 base pair upstream. You can see the mutated area. Here you can see, here there are 6 deletion and 1 addition, 4 deletion, 1 addition, like that is so many changes you can observe in different mutated lines compared to the wild type. Okay, this is how your sequencing file, once after aligning, you will get the result like this. And this is the chromatogram or trace file, which also show that, okay, this is not, didn't came by mistake. It is, they can see a sharp band for chromatogram or peak for A here. Okay, so the mutation, that's all for analyzing the mutation. And this genotypic analysis of mutants, when you analyze it, the mutation can be different type. Sometimes there won't be any mutation. It is not necessary that all will be mutated. In the rice, the mutation efficiency is 40-50%. So if you get a transformant, 100 transformant, you will get a mutated population of approximately 40-50 plants. So sometimes the mutation will be monoallelic, only one allele will be having mutation. But sometimes it will be biallelic, but sometimes can be heterozygous, because two different kind of mutation can happen in both the alleles. And sometimes it will be homozygous. So we will be mainly looking for homozygous biallelic mutation. That also you can make out from your trace file of your sequencing. Here you can see, so two different type sequence with single sharp peak here. So next step, last step, is the phenotypic and molecular biochemical analysis of the CRISPR edited plants. As usual, when you do for other experiments also, you can analyze for the trait which you are looking into. And after, once you confirm this mutation, you can select the best plants with the desired mutation or the desired trait. Then you can go for a NGS or transcript analysis to check the expression. So because you will be getting a large number of plants, so initial step you have to do the Sanger sequencing. And once you get a plant of your interest, then you can later on the stage, you can go for the NGS or transcript analysis. Even whole genome sequencing also can be done to check any off-target effect and that kind of experiment. Even off-target effects can also be analyzed in some other way also, because when you design the guide RNA, the system already gave a list of off-target. You can select that off-targets and design flanking primers for that regions. And you can amplify and sequence it to check whether any editing has happened in that area or not. In that way also, you can check whether any off-target has occurred in your CRISPR editing. So then you can go for the biochemical analysis, which are required for your trait analysis. That's it. So that is, in fact, regarding the research, how you can proceed with your designing construct and developing edited plants. That's that very simple. Everybody can do. So CRISPR-Cas is a very versatile and highly efficient and very precise method. It's very simple. Any lab with the basic molecular biology facilities and genetic transformation facility can go for it. And this is very have potential, obviously, for the crop improvement program. And the speed in which these advancements are made, it is very surely going to revolutionize this field. So I would like to also thank the inventors or the great people or great mind behind the discovery. And this is in news because of the Nobel Prize recently they received, Dodna and Charpentier. And because of their mastermind only, this is possible. But in this regard, I also like to acknowledge another person, another guy, who is Feng Zhang at the Broad Institute of MIT and Harvard. He was also a pioneer in the CRISPR-Cas9 technology. Actually, the story goes like this. The discovery was made by both these groups was almost in a similar time. And Dodna and their coworkers, they filed a patent in the 2012, but their patent was mainly describing the use of CRISPR-Cas9 technology in the bacteria, and lesser was mentioned for the higher organisms. But in his Feng, he also later he filed a patent in 2012 itself, and because his discovery means his claim was mainly for the use of CRISPR in higher organisms, especially human and all. But Feng, he got a patent first than Dodna and team, and then they moved to the court, and the court cases gone for this many years, and the royalty has gone to Dodna and their team. But I think we should also acknowledge Feng Zhang for his pioneering work in CRISPR and its application in higher organism also. So with that, I'm concluding my talk. So if you have any doubt, we can ask, you may please ask her.
Thank you, Dr. Anna. Participants, now it is your time. Please interact with the speaker if you have any doubts.
And Dr. Anna, this is Krishna Radhika. I have a doubt. Ma'am, when we are designing the guide RNA and putting it into the vector, there we have to use this restriction-based technology, or should we go for a golden gate technology at that stage?
If you are having a single guide RNA cloning, you can go for the restriction enzyme technology. But if you have a multiplexing of guide RNA, you use the golden gate assembly.
And after that construct is made, we are transferring it to the binary vector. At that stage, which technology should we use?
Vector which you are using is already binary vector, no? For instantly cloning the guide RNA.
Directly we can clone to the binary vector.
Yes, the vector you are buying from the ARG gene, that is binary vector, that you can directly transform it into